taking a study break.
Yeah, I've been looking at this court case for so long, and I just don't do it.
What's it called again?
Charles River Bridge v. Warren Bridge. I know it's about two bridges, and one was built first, but I just don't get what the big deal is.
Have you tried seeing if they have a Stover Supreme Court special on it?
I've never heard of that.
They're the best! These documentaries got me through AP history.
There. Charles River v. Warren, the Battle of the Bridges.
That looks perfect. Do you mind if I watch it?
You mean we.
I'll wait to talk.
Good evening. Tonight we'll be covering an important Supreme Court case that questioned the contract clause of the Constitution, as well as the effects of technological advances in public policy on a community. I'm your host, Ethan Laun, and this is Stover Supreme Court. Our story begins all the way back in 1630. New residents of the Boston colony declared that whoever builds a ferry system between Boston and Charlestown would be permitted to charge a small toll. Shortly after, a ferry service opened for business and began charging a small toll. The operating rights of the ferry service changed hands twice before the general court granted the rights to a newly established school in Cambridge, Harvard College. While the ferry worked for a while, it grew to become an inconvenience, and passengers desired a change.
I'm tired of not being able to cross this gaping river. Something needs to be done. There must be an easier way to travel besides the ferry.
Your cries have been heard and help has arrived. I will take it upon myself to get a bridge built for us. Given that Harvard will approve such an act.
I don't understand what Harvard has to do with any of this. I mean, why do they care if a bridge is built?
They have the rights to the ferry, remember?
Ferry, right.
You weren't listening, were you?
Maybe you should take my test for me.
Absolutely not.
Over a century passed before 1785 began a chain of events which led to the Battle of the Bridges. Citizens of Massachusetts remained frustrated with the outdated ferry and demanded that the legislature act. Finally, a man named Thomas Russell was given permission by the Massachusetts legislature to construct a bridge over the Charles River. Thomas and his associates, including Boston notable John Hancock, were incorporated as proprietors of the Charles River Bridge. As such, they expected to charge a toll to generate revenue and maintain the bridge. As part of the arrangement, the proprietors of the Charles River Bridge were required to compensate Harvard annually for lost ferry business. The bridge was then to revert to state control after 40 years, but that time frame was eventually extended to 70 years.
There were actually two proposals put forth for the bridge, that of Thomas Russell and of John and Andrew Cabot. Russell's group offered to pay for the bridge themselves, which gave their proposal more appeal. They were profit-seeking, though, unlike the Cabots, which is confusing to many historians, like myself, as to why they lost out. Ultimately, lobbying on account of residents and the Charlestown community was the main reason the Charles River Bridge succeeded, emphasizing the point of welfare for communities in the decision of the case.
The bridge opened to public traffic on June 17, 1786, and was wildly successful. It increased trade and travel, and the bridge remained open in conditions that would have prevented the ferry from operating in the past. However, with the new bridge's success, also came its downfall.
In 1828, the Massachusetts legislature approved the construction of a second bridge across the Charles, built by the newly established Warren Bridge Company. This naturally caused anger amongst the Charles River Bridge Company. The proprietors under Russell assumed that their bridge would continue to operate without competition, but now they were threatened by a bridge in close proximity. This competing bridge would also become toll-free once costs were recouped and profit margins were reached. Whether Russell's monopolized views are correct would become the basis of a Supreme Court case.
You cannot build a bridge next to an already functional one. Doing so is illegal and violates our contract with the state.
The Massachusetts legislature approved the construction of our bridge, therefore making it legal.
And you cannot monopolize this area with your bridge, Russell.
That's exactly right, Stephen.
There were also potential issues concerning unjust taking of private property. After receiving a divided opinion, the proprietors appealed to the United...
I understand now why Harvard was involved, but I'm still a bit confused.
What is it?
So, the Charles River Bridge Company built their bridge.
Right.
But the Warren Bridge Company built a toll-free bridge right next to it, and they were allowed to?
I'm pretty sure.
Why would Massachusetts do that? I mean, you don't need two bridges.
It sounds like you're getting pretty into this documentary.
I need a good grade.
The Battle of the Bridges had now been moved from Massachusetts to a much larger stage, the Supreme Court. Interestingly, the Supreme Court held oral arguments twice, a few years apart, due to complications in cases and Supreme Court personnel. Had the case been decided a couple years earlier, perhaps the ruling would have been different.
If it pleases the court, I will introduce attorneys Daniel Webster and Warren Dutton on behalf of the Charles River Bridge proprietors.
The ferry rights maintained by Harvard College were exclusive. The Charles River Bridge was built and adopted under this same idea. Any other interpretation would impair our contractual obligations.
What and where is the security for other corporate property if the state is allowed to damage such a bridge? The common law speaks to a liberal construction of charters.
The tolls are the essence of the grant. Whether directly or indirectly, a free bridge would subject our bridge to doom.
The abuse of power by the Massachusetts legislature must be corrected. The general confidence of our nation depends on it.
Wow, that was a pretty powerful argument. Those two attorneys seemed really angry about the case.
An angry lawyer is a passionate lawyer. Or so I've heard. Maybe all lawyers are just bad tempered.
I almost feel sorry for the Charles River Bridge Company. It seems like they got blindsided.
Don't say that yet. There's always two sides to every story. Or, in this case, argument.
Now presenting Greenleaf and Davis in defense of the Warren Bridge.
In neither grant for the ferry nor for the bridge is there a mention of executive privilege. The state alone holds this power.
Any negative impact to the Charles River Bridge is merely consequential. Power resides in the people, and the Massachusetts legislature has a duty to benefit those people.
The public convenience demands such improvements as a means of travel. Legislatures have the power of eminent domain to use in support of this goal.
We plead with the court today to use judicial restraint. Allow Massachusetts to meet the demands its community desires.
Dare I say, now is the perfect time for a commercial break. Thanks to our generous sponsor, Dr. Larry Stratton of Waynesburg University, Stover Supreme Court runs commercial free. It took the Supreme Court less than 3 weeks to issue their ruling. Chief Justice Taney authored the majority opinion. It is important to note Taney's reliance on public policy and his perceived relationship between state and judicial functions in this decision.
There is no exclusive privilege given to the plaintiffs over the waters of Charles River, above or below the bridge. Such rights granted to the college cannot, by any sound rule of construction, be used to extend the privileges of the bridge company beyond what the words of the charter naturally and legally import. The charter to the bridge is a written instrument which must speak for itself and be interpreted by its own terms. The object and end of all government is to promote the happiness and the prosperity of the community by which it is established. And it can never be assumed that the government intended to diminish its power of accomplishing the end for which it was created. The continued existence of a government would be of no great value if, by implication and presumption, it was disarmed of the powers necessary to accomplish the ends of its collections, and the functions it was designed to perform transferred to the hands of privileged corporations. While the rights of private property are sacredly guarded, we must not forget that the community also has rights, and that the happiness and well-being of every citizen depends on their faithful preservation. On this day, the court rules in favor of the Massachusetts legislature and the Warren Bridge.
The Supreme Court issued its ruling in favor of the Warren Bridge Company, authorizing the building of a second bridge. However, there is still much to decipher from Chief Justice Taney's opinion.
One of the reasons why the Charles River Bridge decision is so impactful is due to Chief Justice Taney's narrow construction of the charter. In the years before this ruling, contracts have been interpreted more liberally, like in the cases of Fletcher v. Peck and Dartmouth College.
An essential distinction of the Charles River Bridge case is the public nature of the contract. Chief Justice Taney reflects the democratic philosophy of President Andrew Jackson in his decision, heavily weighing the interests and conveniences of the community.
Speaking of philosophy, many people argue that Chief Justice Taney employs the philosophy of utilitarianism, seeking to maximize the greatest happiness for the greatest number of people.
Let's also not forget the historical context of the Charles River Bridge case. Industrialization was underway, and technological progress was increasingly important. Chief Justice Taney worried that if the bridge was to rule to have exclusive privilege, perhaps turnpike corporations would file similar actions to developing railroad companies.
Now, the Charles River Bridge decision was not made without opposition. Justice Story considered himself to be the last relic of past judges, and he was unwilling to accept Chief Justice Taney's legal reasoning. He, along with another dissenter, believed that there was an implied agreement that no other bridge would be constructed. Had the Charles River Bridge proprietors known that they would have to compete with a free bridge, Justice Story believed that they never would have agreed to the grant. While his view was in the minority, it is still important to hear Justice Story's opinion.
Every grant of a franchise is, so far as that grant extends, necessarily exclusive and cannot be resumed or interfered with. It is a contract whose obligation cannot be constitutionally impaired. If we reserve to ourselves the full power and authority to erect other bridges, toll or free bridges, according to our own free will and pleasure, is there a man living of ordinary discretion or prudence who would have accepted such a charter upon such terms? I fearlessly answer no. I maintain that upon the principles of common reason and legal interpretation, the present grant carries with it a necessary implication that the legislature shall do no act to destroy or essentially to impair the franchise.
Just when I think I'm persuaded, another good argument comes along. But I think I'm starting to understand. It seems like the happiness of the community was a pretty big deal in this case.
I agree. I told you these documentaries were good.
I have one last question. This case was decided in 1837. What on earth does it have to do with my test?
Perfect timing. That's how these shows always end.
As we conclude this week's episode on The Battle of the Bridges, we consider its lasting legacy. Many of our viewers were previously unfamiliar with this case, but legal decisions concerning contracts and private property and public access are common. In fact, some of these issues could be impacting you right now.
Consider how some taxi drivers are now being replaced with Uber and Lyft, or consider automated order and delivery services replacing waiters and waitresses. This new competition may be unwelcome for many current businesses, but consumers would likely support the introduction and convenience of new businesses. Sure, these scenarios may not have the same contractual basis that the Charles River Bridge case has, but public benefit is often essential in consideration for many cases.
The Charles River Bridge case introduced a different method of legal analysis than what had traditionally been used in the Supreme Court. Some would say that the case refuted the ideas of private property and eminent domain. However, I think these ideas are still factors, but were outweighed by state and community interests.
We live in a society of creative destruction. Over time, new ideas and innovations will replace the old ones. In certain situations, compensation should be justly awarded for the destruction of property. But as in the Charles River Bridge case, the idea of exclusive privilege over a state function is not always implied.
It is evident that the Charles River Bridge versus the Warren Bridge case significantly impacted the scope of America's legal system. This was one of the first instances in which public welfare may have played an equal part with legal precedent and consideration in the ultimate decision. Thank you for tuning in, and we hope you have enjoyed tonight's coverage of the Battle of the Bridges. From all of us here at Stover Supreme Court Special, good night.
So, what did you think? Pretty cool, right?
Honestly, yeah. I had no idea such old cases could have that big of an impact on the world today. Improvements are important, but I never really thought about how they got there in the first place. Thanks for showing me this. I feel so much better about my exam.
Of course. We both definitely learned something.
What did you learn?
That there's no way you're passing this class without me.
I think I've got a chance, as long as I keep watching these. Oh, great timing. I've got to go. But I'll let you know how I do on that exam.
Good luck.
Thank you. Hey, don't watch the next one without me.